Good afternoon and welcome to the telematics session of accounting. Today I'm doing a very important session with you learners, and that is how to prepare a cash flow statement. So I need you to listen attentively and work with diligence. So in our workbooks, if we can go to page 12, it's activity number 4. There they set out a question on how to do a cash flow. Right, so it's activity number 4. It says, right, whenever you do the cash flow, you first need to see where the financial year ends, and in this case, it's on the 28th of February. You need to read the required part very carefully so that you need to know what they are asking. It says calculate the missing amounts indicated by the letters A, B, and C in the fixed asset or the tangible asset note for the year ended. So that we'll have to find in our answer book. So if we go to the answer book quickly. Okay, here we have the answer book. There we have the letter A, the letter B, and the letter C. This is where we'll do our workings, and then we'll get the final answer over there. Okay, so you need to have the information in front of you. And there you go. Okay, the letter A, that refers to the additions at cost. Okay, very simple. If you look at the land and buildings, they give you the cost and the carrying value at the beginning of the year. Please note that there is never accumulated depreciation on land and buildings. And then they also give you the cost and the carrying value at the end of the year. So in order for us to calculate A, we can clearly see that the cost increased from the beginning of the year to the end of the year, meaning that there must have been an addition in the land and buildings. The way to calculate that, if we go to the calculator, it's 6,740,000 minus 2,689,000. The answer, 4,051,000. Okay. So on your answer page, we need to show that calculation. So we need to show the working 6,740,000 minus 2,689,000. Then the final answer, still on the calculator, 4,051,000. Okay. That was very straightforward. All you had to do there, you just had to get the difference between the carrying value at the end of the year and the carrying value at the beginning of the year. If the carrying value has increased for land and buildings, then immediately you know that there was an addition. In the event that the carrying value has decreased from the beginning to the end of the year, then we would have sold land and buildings. But in this case, the A indicates an addition in land and buildings, and the amount is 4,051,000. Now that is only the land and buildings bought. Right. But if we go back to the question, there's also an indication that we must have bought vehicles, and they give us the amount of 330,000. So we will come back to that line and we're going to use those two figures again. Okay. Let's look at the next part. The next part is the item they want us to calculate, B. Okay. B refers to the disposal at carrying value. Very important, learners, disposal at carrying value. The word carrying value means the cost price minus the accumulated. But it's the cost price of the item that we're selling minus the accumulated of the item that we are selling. Also, clearly they give that information. It says a vehicle was sold for cash at carrying value. So again, carrying value, the cost of the vehicle minus the accumulated depreciation of the vehicle. And it says that the vehicle was sold on the 31st of May. The following extract of the vehicle sold was taken from the fixed asset register. So what we have in front of us is a fixed asset register. So we need to identify the cost price of the vehicle. And it's given. The cost price of the vehicle is 140,000. They're giving us the method of depreciation. It says 20% on the diminishing balance. They also tell us when we bought the vehicle. But in this case, what they did was they filled in all the depreciations for us. Here we can see, because it's the 31st of May 2013, we know immediately that that was the day that the vehicle was sold. It's also repeated in the instruction on top over there. And they're telling us that the depreciation until May was 5,600. But the accumulated depreciation was 33,600. Right? So the accumulated depreciation is 36,000 and the cost price is 140,000. And the letter B, it says calculate the disposal at the carrying value. So for the carrying value, I need the cost price of the item that I'm selling, which is 140,000, minus the accumulated depreciation of the item that I'm selling. Okay. So back to the calculator. It says 140,000 minus 33,600. And the answer is 106,400. Okay, just once again. If it says that you need to identify the disposal at carrying value, you need to determine the book value or the carrying value, which is the cost price minus the accumulated depreciation. The cost price of the vehicle was 140,000. And the accumulated was 33,600. Okay, very important, learners. When we look at the amount on top now for the cost price, the 3,250,000, we now have to take away 140,000. That is the cost price of the item that we are selling. And next to the accumulated, we have to take away next to the accumulated, we have to take away the 33,600. Okay. Because the next step, what they want you to calculate, is the letter C, which says calculate the depreciation. So for the depreciation, we need to go back to the information so that we can see what is happening. Right? That's the letter C. So we're going to have depreciation on old vehicles, we're going to have depreciation on a vehicle that was sold, and we're going to have depreciation on a new vehicle. So for the depreciation on the vehicle sold, that information you will get in your fixed asset register. So if you look at the fixed asset register, the depreciation on the vehicle sold, that is 5,600. Okay, so we go to, so that will be the, so there's no calculation that was given, that was calculated for us, so that was 5,600. Then also the question says that we bought a new vehicle, and that new vehicle, the cost price is 330,000. So we need to find out when that vehicle was purchased or when that vehicle was bought. It says a new vehicle costing 330,000 was purchased and paid for by check on the 1st of January. Right, so remember that our financial year ends the 28th of February 2014. So that new vehicle, we only have it for 2 months. Because we only have it for 2 months, we have to write off depreciation only for 2 months But because it's new, we will have to take it on the cost price and not the diminishing balance. So for the new vehicle, it's going to be 330,000. It's also on the calculator. It'll be 330,000 times 2 divided by 12. And remember, it's because it's new, there's no accumulated, so we have to take the cost price and times 20%. And we get an answer of 11,000. Okay, let's just see if there's some questions. I see there's a question asking where is the 2 months coming from. Let me just see where the 2 months is so we can understand that quickly. The information says it says a new vehicle costing 330,000 was purchased and paid for by check on the 1st of January. So you have the vehicle for January and you have the vehicle for February, and February is also the end of the financial year. So the vehicle will only depreciate for 2 months. Okay, that's why we're going to say 330,000 times 20% times 2 over 12. The 2 months that we have to depreciate it for is for January and for February. Okay, that's where the 2 months is coming from. Okay, I hope that answers that. Okay. Now, there is more depreciation that we have to calculate, and that will be on the vehicles that are remaining. Okay. So now, learners, you must remember, whether we call it the vehicles, the old vehicles, or the remaining vehicles, we will have to calculate the depreciation. And this one, we will have to calculate on the diminishing balance because there is accumulated attached to it. Okay? But you need to remember that we need to take out the accumulated that belonged to the vehicle that was sold. Okay? So just a quick calculation. Remember, the cost price given was 3,250,000. Minus the cost price of the vehicle that we are selling, which was 140,000. So the new cost price, or the cost price of the vehicles that are remaining, will be 3,110,000. Okay, let's just solve that on the calculator. It's 3,250,000 minus 140,000. The 140,000 is the cost price of the vehicle that we are selling. So now when we make the calculation, we need to have 3,110,000 minus whatever the accumulated is of that particular vehicle, and we need a calculation for that also. The accumulated at the beginning of the year on all the vehicles was 1,370,000. So that's the figure that I start with. So the accumulator at the beginning, 1,370,000. Minus the 28,000, which was the accumulated at the beginning. Okay. And that gives me an answer. So let's do that quickly. It's 1,370,000 minus 28,000 and that gives me 1,342,000. Okay, so let's just look at the calculation again quickly. This part is the cost price, and that part is the accumulated depreciation. Okay. That was the opening balance of all the vehicles minus the cost price of the vehicle that was sold. Then we have the cost price of the vehicles remaining. That was the opening balance of the accumulated minus the opening balance of the accumulated of the vehicle that is being sold, and that is what is the accumulated of the vehicle. So the 3 million vehicle has accumulated of 1,342,000. Now we have to subtract that. So when we show the calculation, it's going to be 3,110,000 minus 1,342,000. You get an answer. Then we need to multiply with 20% for the whole year. Okay, so let's just do that on the calculator. It's 3,110,000 minus 1,342,000 gives us an answer of 1,768,000. Then you need to multiply that with 20%. And that is 353,600. Right. Let me just see if there's a question quickly. Okay, this, I see the question is still on the 2 months. Let's just get back to that quickly. Remember that the vehicle was bought in January, and I'm writing off depreciation until the 28th of February. So it says the 1st of January until the 28th of February, and that gives me the 2 months. So in my calculation, that is where the 2 months is coming from over there. Okay. Let's just check quickly. I see this, the question is the 28,000. The 28,000 is the accumulated at the end of last year. The 28,000 is accumulated at the end of last year, which is the beginning of the new financial year, which is the 1st of March 2013. So at the end of last year, the 28th of Feb 2013, but that's also the 1st of March 2013. Last year's closing balance is this year's opening balance. So the 28,000 is included in the total above. Okay. Then all we have to do, we have to calculate the depreciation. So we take it the depreciation on the vehicle that was sold, that was given, the depreciation on the new vehicle, which was 11,000, and the depreciation on the old vehicle, and we add those three figures together, and then we should get the answer for depreciation. So on the calculator, we still have the depreciation of the old, so we just have to add the 5,600. And we have to add the 11,000. And that gives us the depreciation for the year, which is 370,200. Right, the 353,600 is only the depreciation on the old vehicle. 11,000 is the depreciation on the new vehicle, and 5,600 is the depreciation on the vehicle that was sold. So we have to add those three depreciations together because the letter C wants us to calculate the depreciation for the year. That's the depreciation on all the vehicles. So it's going to be the depreciation on the sold, which is 5,600, the depreciation on the new, which is 11,000, and the depreciation on the old, which is 353,600. We add the three together, then we get 370,200. Right, the question here, I see. Okay, there. That, learners, we've got that now. Okay. Right, then, very important, learners, we're going to come back to any of those figures that we now calculated in the fixed asset register, and we're going to apply the information in the cash flow. Okay. Must remember that the cash flow, the layout, which is very important, okay, and we need to know where the figures must go and whether the figures must be with or without a bracket indicating a cash inflow or a cash outflow. That in this activity, it says the cash flows from operating activities. That's the first part of the cash flow. Then we have cash flows from investing activities, which is the middle part, cash flow of financing activities. And the sum of those three will give us the answer at the bottom, which is the net change in cash and cash equivalents. And there is a figure already in. And then eventually we will get to the same answer. But we need to do it step by step. Work very carefully, so any calculations in brackets, so that we can get the marks at the end of the year, please. Right? We see that given is the note cash generated from operations. So that is generally note number one that comes from your cash flow. In this activity, that note was not necessary for us to do because they already gave us the final answer. Also, the interest paid, that was also given, but we can also get that from the information. Right. There we have the interest, the 88,500, and that is where that particular item is coming from. Please take note that if it says interest paid, you have to show it with brackets indicating it's an outflow. That's very important, learners. Right. Then there's two blank lines. The first one we're going to have is going to be dividends paid. Right, so the dividends paid is we need to ask ourselves, who do we pay the dividends to? Right, the dividends is paid, that's right, the dividends is paid to the shareholders. So in your information marked B, it's an extract of the balance sheet. They're giving us balances of shareholders. And at the bottom of that page, there's information D, which is also regarding dividends. So we need to look at the balances of the shareholders, and we need to look at the dividends. Okay. But clearly, you can see at the bottom, it says an interim dividend paid on the 31st of August 2013, and a final dividend declared, which means the 870 was not paid because we haven't paid that yet. And you can check to see if the final dividend and the balance of the shareholders for February 2014 should be exactly the same figure. There's a balance for the shareholders 870, which means that is this year's final dividend, which we did not pay. So what did we pay in respect of dividends? Clearly, we had to pay last year's opening balance, which was 480,000. Okay. So next to the words dividends paid, you're going to show a calculation in brackets. You're going to say that we paid 480,000. That was the final dividend of last year that we didn't pay, plus the interim dividend of this year, which is 750,000. So in total, the dividends paid will be the 480, the balance of the shareholders of last year, plus the 750 interim dividend that you have paid this year. So we just have to add those two figures together. So it's going to be the 480,000 plus 750,000. And that gives us 1,230,000. Very important, you need to indicate that it's an outflow, and you have to put the amount of 1,230,000 in brackets, and that's the total for the dividends. That's just, once again quickly, the dividends paid will be the opening balance, which means last year's closing balance, 480, plus the interim dividend of 750,000. We just have to add those two to get the amount over there. Let's just check if there's any questions on that. Right, it's going on the cash flow. How do I get the dividends paid? I think we've answered that now. Let's just make sure everybody gets it. It's the opening balance, which is last year's closing balance of 480,000, plus the interim dividend of 750,000. So for the dividends paid, opening balance of the shareholders plus the interim dividend gives me a total of 1,230,000. Okay. The next item is going to be tax paid. Right. So we pay the tax over to SARS, and in this case it will be SARS income tax. So we need to look at the opening and the closing balance for SARS, which you'll find in the balance sheet, and we also need to look at the income tax figure, which you'll find in the extract of the income statement. So on the extract of the income statement, you find the figure for income tax, which is 441,000. So we're going to need that figure. Right? Then also, you need to be very careful when it gets to SARS, because as you know, SARS can be classified as a current liability, then we owe SARS money, or SARS can be classified as a current asset, then SARS owes us money, which means SARS can, when it's classified under the current liabilities, it means it's a payable, and when it's classified under the current assets, then it is a receivable, meaning that we've overpaid SARS, now SARS is classified as a debtor, he owes us the 128,000. Okay? So to get the amount that was paid for tax, we take the figure that we owed him last year, plus the income tax figure, which is 441,000. So that's under the payables of last year, plus the income tax, plus the amount that we have overpaid, because now SARS is a debtor, so the 128 will also have to be added. So it's the opening balance, plus the tax, plus the amount that we've overpaid because now SARS is classified as a debtor, then we add those three figures together and then we'll get the amount that was paid for tax. Okay, so the opening balance was 122,000 plus 441,000 plus 128,000. And the answer comes to 691,000. Remember, we are paying, so we will have to show the SARS amount that we're paying in respect of tax in brackets. Okay, let's just see if there's a question. I see the question is still on the 870 that is not paid in respect of dividends. If it's not paid, then it means that we owe the shareholders the money, the 870. That is how much the 870 is, how much we owed them in respect of last of this year, which means the final dividend was declared, but it's not paid. That's why the final dividend and the balance of the shareholders should be the same figure. The final dividend declared on the 28th of February is 870. That means the 870 was not paid. That's why it's the balance. So what was paid was the opening balance of the 480,000 plus the 750,000 interim dividend that was paid. That's why we just added those two figures together to get the dividend that was paid. Okay. We can also do another way to make sure that we get the tax is by reconstructing a SARS income tax account, and then we can see if we are if we have calculated the figure correctly. So what I'm doing, I'm reconstructing a SARS income tax account. The opening balance of SARS was under the payables. There it is. It was under the payables, meaning the opening balance was a credit. It was 122,000. Okay. Now what I want to calculate is how much tax was paid. In other words, the bank figure on the debit side, that is how much tax was paid. Now normally that bank figure on the debit side is divided into three, the first payment and then the two provisional payments. Now we just want to calculate all three banks together. The item that also goes in the SARS account is income tax on the credit side, which is 441,000. That's also given as part of the information. Then we draw the tram lines. Then we insert the balance of this year below the tram lines. Very important, learners. That the next balance that I'm going to put into the account will be the balance below the tram lines. Okay? So that is the opening balance. That's for February 2013. That's the income tax. So now I'm looking for the balance for 2014 for SARS. And SARS appears for 2014. It appears under the current assets, meaning that is a debit balance below the totals or below the tram lines. So I'm putting in the 128. That is my balance drawdown. So surely we all know that the balance drawdown must have been a balance carried down above the totals. And if I insert the 128 over there, meaning that to get the amount for the tax that was paid, I just have to add those three together. And that's exactly what we did. And then we came to 691,000. Okay. So now we know that whether I reconstruct the SARS account, like we have it over here, or we just do it in the brackets over here, it has to be the same. What's very important for us to remember is that a cash outflow, because money is being spent, money is leaving the company, it has to be shown in brackets, please. Right. Then, because we have all four figures now, we can calculate the amount for cash flows from operating activities. The first two figures is given, so you need to make sure that you use those two figures when you want to get the final answer. So it's 69,600 minus 88,500. Why minus? Because it's in brackets. Minus 1,230,000. And minus 691,000. Then the final answer is a negative, meaning that the cash flows from operating activities will be a negative, which is 103,900. Okay, it's a negative, so that's why the total on top will also have to be in brackets. Just check if this anything to do with that. Okay, question is on the tax. I think we've handled the tax. Okay. Then we move on. We move on to the second part of the cash flow. It says cash flows from investing activities. Okay? So if it's investing activities, we need to know that it's going to be fixed assets purchased or fixed assets bought. Now we have to come back to the first part of the question, which asks us the letter A, calculate the land and buildings that was bought. And the land and buildings was only 4,051,000. That was only land and buildings. But also in the question, there was a part where we bought a new vehicle. And it says fixed asset sports, meaning land and buildings, vehicles and equipment. So the value of the land and buildings was 4,051,000. And the cost price of the vehicle that was bought was 330,000. There was no mention of equipment in the question. So the fixed assets purchased or the tangible assets purchased will just be the sum of those two together. So it's going to be 4,051 plus 330. That gives us 4,381,000. Let's just repeat that quickly. It says fixed assets purchased, 4,051,000 plus 330,000 gives you 4,381,000. We are buying, money is leaving the company, so the total will have to go in brackets indicating a outflow. Right, the second line will be for the proceeds of fixed assets sold. Okay. Again, back to the first part of the question. The letter A, that was just for the land and buildings. The letter B was for the disposal, and we sold the vehicle for 106,400. So that's how much money we received when we sold the vehicle. So that will be the proceeds of the fixed assets sold, which is just 106,400. No brackets, because that is seen as an inflow. Okay, let's just check. Okay, now we have to offset those two figures. So on your calculator, we still have the 43810, but that's a negative. Right, so we just have to take, let's just rather clear this, just not to cause any confusion. You're going to start with your positive number, which is 106,400, and you're going to minus 4,381,000. It's a negative, meaning that that total will also go in brackets, and it's 4,274,600. So far we have two parts of the cash flow. In the easier part, or the item at the bottom, which has got to do with cash flows from financing activities. So we need to look at the shares, and we need to look at the increase or the decrease of the loan. So for that we need to go back to the part of the question where they talk about shares. So that will be the letter C. Right? They give you the shareholders register. Under C, they say at the beginning of the financial year, there was 1.2 million shares in issue. On the 31st of March, 300,000 shares were issued at a trend. That means we've issued new shares, money has come into the company. So your first line here will be proceeds of shares issued. But we've issued 300,000 shares, and it was issued at 8 rand, So all we have to do, we have to multiply with 300,000 CS times 8 Rn. That will give me 2,400,000. We check that on the calculator. So it's 300,000 CS times 8 gives you 2.4 million. We are receiving that money. It is seen as a cash inflow, therefore no brackets. Okay, that was a new issue. What can also happen is we can repurchase. So we need to check in the information to see whether we have repurchased any shares. Right, on the 31st, it was 300,000 issued at 8 Rand. That was the new issue. On the 31st of December, it says the company bought back 50,000 shares from a dissatisfied shareholder, S. Smith, at 9.50 each. So that was the buyback price that we need. They go further, they give us information regarding the average, which was 6 Rand, which we're not going to need because we want the amount that the total amount that the shares was bought back at, which was 9.50 Rand. So it was 50,000 shares that we bought back at 9.50 Rand. So if we go to the calculator, we need to find out how much money we spent. So it was 50,000, the number of shares that we bought back, multiply with 9.50 Rand, which is 9.5, the answer of 475,000. So it's going to be repurchase of shares, 50,000 multiply 9.50 Rand. That gives us 475,000. The repurchase, we are buying, the company is spending money, so the 475,000 will be indicated in brackets to indicate that it is a outflow. Let's just check if there's any questions on that. Right, we've got the question on the number of shares that was issued. They give you the number of shares that was issued, which was 300,000, and it was issued at 8 Rand. And then we just have to multiply and then get the answer. We can also issue different quantities at different prices, and then we have to add those answers together to get the total. Right, then the repurchase, you need to take the whole amount and you do not split the buyback price between the average and the amount more than the average, because we want to know how much we paid for the shares altogether. That's why it's going to be 50,000 times 9.50 Rand, which gives me the 475,000. It's an outflow, and I need to indicate that by putting that figure in brackets. I think the last part of that particular section for the financing activities has got to do with the loans. So we need to look at what has happened with the loan from the end of last year to the end of this year. Last year, the loan was 508,000, or meaning that they ended with that figure last year and they also started with that figure this year. So it started with 508 and they're ending with 908. So clearly the loan increased by 400,000. So now we received 400,000, and that was for an increase in the loan. 908,000 minus 508,000. That gives me 400,000. We fold the three figures in the particular block. So now all we have to do, we just have to add those figures together to get the amount on top. So we're going to start with 2,400,000. We're going to minus 475,000. And we're going to add 400,000. And the answer will be 2,325,000. Right? Just once again, quickly. It was the issue of the shares, 300,000 times 8 rand. That gives you 2.4 million. No brackets because it's seen as an inflow. Money is flowing into the company. When we repurchase, we look for the total amount and not the split between the average and the amount more than the average. That is seen as a cash outflow, hence the brackets. Our loan increased from 508 to 908, so we received 400,000, no brackets. We offset those three figures. We get the cash flows from activities on top. Then, learners, what we have to do, we have to take the answers of all the respective blocks. We have to add them together, and it should give us the net change in cash and cash equivalents, this line over here. Okay. So for that, it's 2,325,000. Minus 4,274,600. Minus 1,039,900. And the answer is a negative 2,989,500. Meaning that more money has flown out of the company than coming in. Okay? That's why there's a negative. As you can see, it's 1,039,900, the 4,274,600, and the only positive is the 2,325,000. That's why there's a negative. The net effect of those three answers will give you that. Now, at the bottom, it says cash and cash equivalents at the beginning of the year. And it says cash and cash equivalents at the end of the year. We can get that information from the there's our cash and cash equivalents at the beginning of the year, and there was no overdraft, so we must check. You always check to see if there's an overdraft. If there is an overdraft, then you offset the two figures. If there's no overdraft, then you take the figure as it is. That's why the 2,488,000 appears next to the line cash and cash equivalents at the beginning of the year. Right. Then for the 2014, there is 13,000 a positive, and there's an overdraft of 515,000. So now we have to offset those two figures, meaning 515,000 is a negative because it says overdraft, and 13,500 is a positive, so we have to offset that. So when we do that, we can say 13,500 is the positive, and the negative is 515,000. So your final answer here will also be a negative, which is 13,500 minus 515,000. It should be 501,500. Then a means of testing to see if the difference between the net change and the cash and cash equivalents at the beginning of the year also gives you 501,500. So if we test that, at the beginning of the year, we had 2,488,000. And there was a net change of 2,989,500, but it's in brackets, meaning it's an outflow, so we have to minus the 2,989,500, and you get a negative 501,500 like we have at the bottom. Okay, let's just check if there's any more questions. Okay, we've dealt with that. Right, there was just a question on why don't we calculate the interest. We don't have to calculate the interest when it gets to the cash flow unless they specifically tell us in the information that the interest was already calculated and we're not using the interest. All we want to do is we want to get the difference between the loan to see how much of the loan was repaid or whether we received an additional loan. And in this case, it was 508 and it went to 908, so we received an extra 400,000. I think that answers that question. Then the question is still on the 13,500. That is in the information. The 13,500 is next to the line cash and cash equivalents, 13,500. And then there's a bank overdraft of 515,000. So we have to offset those two figures and then you'll get the answer of 501,500, but a negative because the bank overdraft figure is seen as a negative and the cash and cash equivalents is seen as a positive. I think, learners, thank you very much for listening attentively. This is a very important section of the work. We need to make sure that you know the layout, you know how to calculate the figures like we were doing today. There's lots of information. You need to make sure that you know the information that we're going to, what the examiner wants, and where you need to apply the brackets and the no brackets. I wish you everything of the best when you answer the cash flow for your midterms and for the end of the year. And hopefully you score good results in accounting. Thank you very much.